My name is Peter Hilbers, and I have the honor to present you something about research data management here at the TUE. And this is not my single effort, I would say, that apart from being the dean of the Department of Biomedical Engineering, but I'm part of the steering group on research data management at TUE, and two members of them are Twan Kuiper and Mark Scheffer, and they also contributed strongly to this presentation. In fact, they did many things. You see, the word roadmap is being mentioned, and that's definitely saying that we already are following a road. Yeah, and what I today will do is to show you where we're standing now. Yeah, and also explain to you what steps have we have taken so far. And there will be a next lecture series in terms of looking into the future. And then Van Kuiper will give a presentation, for instance, about something else, or somebody else, about data stewards and health data portal. There are important things that are ongoing. And at the end of the session, you should know both about data stewards and about the health data portal, something at least. So what I will do is give you an idea about what we did so far. And to some extent, I'm saying I'm really pleased that although the audience, something like I think 50 people are in the audience, if I would have given this presentation, I would say 2 years ago, then there will be 10 people or something like that. So indeed, we are making a step forward. And one of the big issues, I would say, but also with research data management, is to get people involved, at least aware of all kinds of things that are ongoing with respect to RDM. Now, what we're going to do is, I would say, something about what is the challenge. Next, I will say something about try to at least quantify it, to say, what are we facing, how long, and also say something about costs involved. So that's an extremely difficult thing, and I will explain that later on. And last but not least, I will say something about what have we done so far, and also say looking forward, also some kind of introduction to coming lectures, for instance, about Federico Toshi and Twan Kuiper. I'm not the only speaker today. Today there will be also Leon Ozinski will also say something in terms of what the innovation lab and involvement is with respect to supporting the research data management cycle. Okay, the challenge. Now you can have many different, I would say, aspects to look at. Perhaps the bottom one is perhaps the most interesting one from research point of view. Yeah, and also if I speak to Frank Baerens, who's a rector, and his statement is, he says, data is extremely high value. Every now and then he uses it as being the new oil, others say it's the gold or even the diamonds. And so apparently data is getting more and more important. We know that. Every day you see that in the newspaper or wherever, in the articles, it's all about artificial intelligence, machine learning, big data, etc. So, but that's not the only thing, of course. First of all, you should always think that one of the things that also is going on, at least in the scientific arena, is about integrity. And one of the things is about research data management is that we at least think that if you look at the RDM, then at least it should be clear that to safeguard the tractability of data, to make it more secure, etc. So apart from all things that have to do with external reuse, etc., then at least we think that it also is a means to increase the scientific integrity of our data. Secondly, perhaps people always state that as first, they say that if you look at grant suppliers like NWO and the European Union, then they are now already requiring for each proposal that there's also a paragraph, a section, about research data management. You should promise somehow that you will have a good research data management plan, whatever that may mean. Later on we will see more detail, but should be reflected that, and also I think Leon will say something about that. If you looking at people, then we every now and then get that question here, sort of TUE, what is it research data, what should be in it? So now, first of all, we should be clear about what research data management is. So next slide will definitely give you also a definition about what we consider as being research data management. But to be quite honest, there is no generally accepted definition of it. So that's our personal way to describe it. Then number four, you could say that, we say, at least if you look at the RDM practices, then we are definitely facing a problem. That will later on state it more clearly what really the problem is. If you look at RDM, then RDM is always connected to what's called FAIR, findable, accessible, interoperable, reusable. And I will explain, we say simply FAIR, and there's not a single FAIR. In fact, there are six different levels of fairness. So I will address them and also explain what fairness is meaning. Then you've also heard that yesterday also there was a presentation of the board of the university. We are now and then dealing what was called with Plan S, yeah, in terms of Coalition S, in which we have open science, meaning that every article being published here or being produced here at the university should be open, yeah, for the audience in a broader sense of the word. And you see, open science, as open as possible, you immediately connected it as close as necessary, because especially at our university, we have a lot of collaborations with companies, yeah, and that can also mean that not all data is open accessible. So that's also something you should be aware of. Now, coupled with scientific integrity, there's also all kinds of deals with respect to security and with respect to privacy. And especially if you look at the health data portal, later on I will say something about that, then there you see that privacy is definitely, yeah, an issue. And last but not least, to end with it, yeah, it has value. Clearly, data is getting more and more important. Now, where started? What is our goal if you look at the plans here at the TUE? And you could say that we have two different goals. Goal number one is to say, yeah, that we should be more aware of RDM and the levels of RDM. Everybody is already now doing some kind of RDM, perhaps without noticing it. Yeah, but in fact what you want to do is to increase the level of RDMness, you could say. We come back to that. But more important, we say you want to support the research lifecycle. And I will zoom in on the research lifecycle later on, because there are many things going on. If you look at that, we'll come back to that. If you go to the first phase, you could say if you write a proposal, then usually you start with some kind of plan. You design a plan. The next step is, of course, assuming that the plan is being accepted, being funded, etc. Then you will go somehow come into the phase what's called collecting and capturing the data. Of course, if you have the data without doing anything that it makes no sense, so the next step is usually some kind of analysis. Then, also, almost everybody's doing that every day. You somehow are going to manage your data. Let's see over there. And hopefully, the data is that interesting that you can publish it. Coupled to an article, something like that. Then something is happening. Because everything so far, looking at design, collection, analysis, management, and publish, it's all within the responsibility of the researcher. The next step is about archive and using it. At that very moment, there's something changing, also with respect to ownership. So the first steps are always something the researcher, I'll come back to that. If you're going to archiving it, at that very moment, you could say that the ownership is changing from the individual to the organization, in this case, the TUE. And that's an extremely important step, and we should look at that, what's happening there. Apart from the research lifecycle, we, of course, in terms of RDM, looking how to support it, all phases, all different phases of the research cycle. And of course, immediately connected to it is some kind of infrastructure. What kind of storage facilities are there? Or what kind of things are there, yeah, in terms of analyzing the data? That kind of things, yeah, should also come there. You see, there will also be a policy, and that's getting important because we expect, you're looking at scientific integrity, that there will also be something like a data integrity paragraph in which you indeed promise to behave nicely with respect to data. And last but not least, and that's in fact where we started maybe, is part of the awareness. Be aware of what good RDM is. And as you can see, these are the two major goals. But, and that's something like, you say, to stimulate indeed to behave like a good RDMer. You say, it's not only about external motivation, not about research funding, etc. It has a lot of advantages. Here you see a long list of different advantages. I will not go through all of them. But first of all, you could say that every now and then it's happening that you will lose somehow of the data, whatever that happens, especially if you have local storage, like a USB stick or something else. It's happening every day that a student of you comes to you and say, oh, I have lost my data. And at least we think that RDM may partly solve that problem. But it has also to do with policy, also how students behave. It can improve your workflow, you can see level the insights, and so there's a long list of what good RDM is. Now let's first go then to say what's it not. Usually it's easier to say, if we would not have RDM and we would not have something about principle called FAIR, then you will end up with like a haystack here, and there's indeed the cartoonist is saying, somewhere there's a needle. So you cannot find, there's a large, big pile of data without knowing anything about where the needle is or even knowing where the haystack is. So, yeah, this is that a cartoon. Looking at the fairness, I already used the term fairness, and everybody is to some level already behaving fair, you could say. If you're doing nothing, perhaps you call it non-fair, but in fact you are staying at level one. At least if you look at fairness, we have four different terms: findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable. The first step is, if you have data, somehow you have had a permanent identifier. Like a URL you have for web pages, also all data will somehow have an identification. At the moment you have that, you're already at level two. So, the moment you have, say, registered your data, you're already at level two. That's not the level you want to be. The level you want to be is, in fact, I would say level five, but yeah, what's in between? If you're going from level one to level two, so level one is meaning it's usable for humans, this is the extremely difficult part. I would say the big challenge with respect to RDM is metadata. Usually we have an enormous amount of data we're producing. Somehow you should organize the data in such a way that indeed it is findable for machines. Like if you have a tweet, if you have a long text, if you do not know any way to add the hashtags, yeah, then it's very difficult to find that tweet. So you should show something about adding additional information to the data such that it indeed makes sense and can be found. That's the metadata, and nobody at the moment has a solution for it. Although here at the university we're working on it and we are trying to support that. The next step from level 3 to level 4 is at the moment that you have the data, you have the metadata, you also have documented, etc. You're given the history, how it's being produced. Yeah, then you're ending level 4, but it not necessarily means that it's accessible. It can very well be that the access is restricted. So especially if you look at all kind of collaborations we have with companies, it might very well be that we're ending here. That still we are fair, we have PIDs, we have metadata, it can be found, but only for a limited audience. The next step, and that's what really we're striving for, is level 5. Level 5 is meaning it is fair, everything, and also your data is accessible for the whole world. So this is in fact the level we are striving for. Yeah, mostly we are at the TUE at this level. Apart from if you have publications every now and then in Nature or Science, then you're even obliged now to put your data into a data repository, and there you are at level 5. So it depends on what kind of research you're doing. And level 6 is in fact meaning you have everything in level 5 open, and also you have linked it to each other. So you have your complete organization at one. I would say the big step is most people are still somehow facing the big problem of metadata. Yeah, and we most people also end up at level 4. Now here's it once again explained. I already did it. Now what are we doing? What is the trend internationally? Now here you have that level 4 data. And what you see is that there's all kind of facilities now being offered. In general, if you look at the different solutions, then one of the most perhaps simple things is storage. Simply storing your data. But there are costs involved. I come back to that, so that's not always that simple in that sense. And you see examples like Zadara, NAS, but the difficulty is that everybody is using all different kinds of storage facilities. Either being USB sticks, NAS, external hard drives, whatever you have, and they are usually hardly accessible. For instance, if you look at your own laptop and you have your hard disk, then it's not accessible for others. So that's meaning it's very restricted with respect to access. On top of it, there is already development what's called middleware, and there is the international trend to go to IRODs. IRODs is something like an open system in which they are, it's called integrated rule-oriented data system, so nobody is ever saying that term, always everybody is stating IRODs. Yeah, and it somehow offers you things for management of data, and it does already something with respect to metadata. But don't expect too much from it. The involvement of research is extremely large, but it's at least being used worldwide. If you are really going to what we need, on top of it, we have those applications like high-performance computing, like electronic lab journal, and that kind of things. Yeah, all are going to use IRODs, as lower level, lower le- the middleware level, yeah, but somehow we have to make the connection. This is, could say, more general, this part. Here you find general solutions. The step from application to the lower levels is usually depending on the kind of project. So we expect that we have to find special interfaces depending on the kind of project to facilitate the IROS here and also the archiving. Now here again, but now in a more usable perhaps scheme about the research life cycle, but here most importantly on the slide is what we think that research data management is. Our statement is that research data management is the organization of data from its entry to the research cycle through the dissemination and archiving of valuable results. That's simply a definition, but there's a very special term in it that's called valuable results. And that's extremely difficult because producing data is extremely easy. You can produce enormous amounts of data. Even this is being taken up by YouTube. If you look at the amount of bytes being produced, that's incredible. But is it valuable or not? So how to make indeed, instead of having data, make information out of it. So this really, that point is going from data to information is where we're dealing with. Now, how big is it? Now, if you, what are the requirements? First of all, our projects usually last for PhD projects like 4 years. But that's not it. If you are looking at all requirements, then we have an article, all kind of articles require that you store your data for at least 10 years. If you look at costs within projects, then they are only covered in the first 4 years. So that meaning automatically that after those 4 years, when the project has ended, somebody else should take care of the costs because they are not eligible in the projects. First and secondly, in the plan phase, we also can show you that we have what you should add to your proposal. So we have a data management plan, perhaps also Leon will say something about that. And if needed, we also can say something about what's called the privacy impact assessment. If data has to be secured and other kind of things, we can arrange it for that. That's all in the plan phase. In the research phase, I already made a statement, apart from the archiving, it is the data is the ownership is by the department or better state by the individual. Or if you're working with people together, it's still in the department. We have what we call an infrastructure. Yeah, and that infrastructure is at the moment, yes, you said you're going to in fact going to archiving. That's in fact what's happening at the moment, you also ending it into the system. The next step is you're not alone because we're helping you in that process by the use of data stewards, and Van de Kuiper will in one of the coming lectures tell you about the data stewards and how we are going to organize that. What is the rule of thumb? If you look at the cost of it in the project, then roughly stated, if you look at the total project cost, some 5% of the budget should be allocated for RDM. That's the rule of the thumb. We do not know if that's the right number or not, but it seems to be the rule of thumb. Well, everybody then is used that. It might very well be that the number is too low, so that in future you should say that it will be 10% allocated to research data management. And I'll explain something about the cost later on. If you look at our university, then we have the difficulty there. If you ask other universities and they ask about how much data is there on a year basis, then they end up with a number something in between 20 and 30, as you can see, petabytes. At least the data that's being stored. There's much more data being produced, but it's the data being stored. If you look at the university, then officially, it's something like 0.3, 0.5 petabyte is at the university level. But we know that at the different departments, there's much more data going on. Like on NAS devices, you see that the amount of petabytes. So we also expect for the TUE that there's something like 80 to 20 petabytes in the departments. So at the moment, for the archiving, it's only use for those 0.3. If you look at the costs, the MUPACE, I already made that statement. Now about the data and the archiving, etc. I all made those things clear. Now looking at costs. And now it's getting more difficult because it's not completely clear what storage is meaning. You have all kind of storage types. If you have data that is should be immediately available, we call it online storage, then you see that it's the highest cost. So roughly, if you look at 1 terabyte per year, it costs you around 700 euros. If you have data that is less accessible, like you're going to an Amazon Glacier, that is only something like 120 or 60 euros, depending if you have writing permissions or anything down. So roughly stated, depending on the kind of storage, there's a factor of 100 for between the most expensive solution and the cheaper solution. So that's 1 terabyte. But we are speaking about, say, the expectation is that we are producing at least 100 terabytes per year. It means on year basis, we have something like 70,000 euros for cost for only storage, for archiving. If we have to store the data for 10 years, then you're ending up with something like 675,000 euros. And it's only if we would have 100 terabytes. And we expect to have something like 80 to 20 petabytes. So that number is much larger than is being stated out. But for sure, at the moment, it is the number. Now, if you do the calculation, you say this current situation, assume that we would have additionally 100 terabytes per year. And for the more expensive solutions, you're already talking about 3.7 million euros. Yeah, but for the cost of data. So the amount of data of cost involved in research data management is getting larger and larger in the coming years. At least it's in the millions. So if you are looking at larger plans, etc., keep be aware of the costs involved in the RDM. Now, what have we done so far? Now, in fact, we started in 2017 with the RDM. And we first thing we did is some kind of inventorization in all departments to find out what's already going on with respect to research data management in each department. Based upon that inventorization, we came up with 5 pilots. Yeah, and here you see them. Yeah, we also produced a report about it in terms of what's called IT for research. And an RDM program was part of it. We selected 5 pilots, and those pilots were known as the Electronic Lab Journal, because if you look at in the past, all things were being handwritten, so people wrote it down in some kind of logging book or something like that, and they had all questions about chemicals and chemical distributions, so we thought we have to come up with a nice IT solution for that. And that's called Electronic Lab Notebook, and that's working, that's being implemented. Within the Department of Information Engineering and Information Science, they had a system called ARGI, and they also collected data. It's definitely not fair, not even fairness level 4, it's perhaps fairness level 2 or fairness level 3, depends on it. So it was not acceptable for us as a general solution for RDM. There's also a lot of discussions, at least in the computer science, about what we call software repositories, like GitHub and GitLab were being used. They have to be careful with it because they are usually not secure. You cannot, if you have, for instance, patient data, you are not allowed to put them into GitHub because it's accessible by the whole world, depending on what kind of information you're doing. We had a lot of discussions about security. There's also now the fact that's being followed up by the GDPR, looking at all aspects with privacy in the RDM. There was a pilot on OpenML, on machine learning. Joachim Verschoor was leading that, and he is in fact world leading, you could say, in that aspect, especially with machine learning and also adding metadata to it. That's one of the things that's still ongoing. And last but not least, and that's one thing from Frederik Botoshi. He will also next time tell about that, especially in high performance computing, they are producing large amounts of data and that data has to be followed. So you need all kind of tracer and workflow information about both the data, but also the software is producing it. Because if you have to store data for 10 years, it very well may be the case that you use an algorithm from 5 years ago that is already gone within those 5 years. So you have also not only to store the data, you also have to store the algorithm and the way the data is being produced. Now, if you look at where we're standing in the research life cycle, then you can have, you can look at the inner cycle, and this is the outer cycle. So we did a lot of things on about awareness. We did things on looking at the infrastructure. We also wrote down things about policy. If you look at the different phases here, then it's more, I would say, misty picture, because it depends on the kind of projects you have. Some projects indeed are already fair, and others are not fair at all. So it depends on the kind of project. That's why those marks meaning, if you see a green mark, that's meaning indeed satisfying all requirements, and something And this is a signal that it's not completely yet current to standards. This is meaning definitely it's not current to standards. So here you see that, yeah, in depending on the phase you're in your research life cycle, in some cases, some projects, they are fair, and other cases, they are not. If you look at our RDM program, then we try to have departments, because the researchers should be involved. So we have a strong now involvement of each department. There is an RDM person that's now either already operational or looking for people to do that. We have also seen that we are producing scientific, that RDM will have a paragraph in the scientific integrity code of the TUE. And we expect that each student, either at the PhD level or at the master level, has also to fill in that he or she is behaving with respect to research data managed according to the rules of the TUE. So we especially look at form one or form two for people involved, that there will also be a paragraph about research data management. And we have already an implementation plan that is in bold about data stewards. That's something Twan will address. And we are looking forward to courses in which we at least should tell our students about how good RDM will be. And with respect to budget allocation, the discussions on the universities are ongoing for the amount of money that should be available for RDM in the coming years. If you look at what we are currently doing, then we are looking indeed at storage and the different facilities to storage. There's a way called CEF, and especially that is different from traditional, because it also allows us to have data being stored in which you have also external parties involved. So everything with respect to security is then guaranteed, and especially if you look at the health data portal, then it's one of the aspects. If you have patient data from hospitals or whatever, then it should be secure environment to store the data in. It's being used indeed during the research process. We are looking now into the IROTS. We are using it, and there will also we expect also that within this year there will also be tools available to produce metadata, but the involvement of researchers will be extremely hard. We also one of the important things with respect to metadata and interoperability is findability, and there we developed what's called a data catalog, in which you organize all data so that indeed it can be found by all kind of algorithms and computers. We have one big, could say, project ongoing. That's in the phase of going to implementation. At the moment it's a proof of concept, but later on this year definitely we're also going to implement it, and then we are having the first, large project in which we have also our RDM program running. And last but not least, we are looking at the policy and the training. We expect indeed that students and staff members will somehow have a training available in which they can treat their data according to the rules. Now, although I made a statement, there are two main things ongoing. One is data stewardship, and Van Kuipers will, I think in April, will give a lecture about that. And the health data portal will also be one of the topics for the coming period. What I did not address that exclusively is what's going on in the Netherlands, because we want to address that at the moment we are dealing with the health data portal. Let me give you an overview also what others are doing. But the involvement of, we are strongly involved in all developments in the Netherlands, for instance with Surf Sahara on data management, and we're looking also at other universities like Nijmegen and Maastricht and Rotterdam, what they are doing also on RDM. If you look at how we are standing, then I would say in some cases we are a front, in other cases we are following the general rules. That's in half an hour the current status about RDM. And obviously, any questions? Peter. Sorry, I come something closer.
About your last remark, you said in some areas we're leading, in other ones we're
leading. If you look at, for instance, at metadata, it depends, of course. But if you speak about machine learning and metadata, we are definitely leading. For instance, Joachim Peschoor is known internationally that he is doing that. But in general, I already made a statement that the big challenge, I would say, for research data management, going to level 3 or level 4, is producing metadata. It's extremely difficult if you have a large amount of data, how you should organize it, and what kind of additional information you should add to it, that indeed others can find it. Because you have your own, everybody has his own organization scheme, but in fact it should be findable by others. And that is, think about it, how you organize your folders, your directories, and your own structure. Yeah, what kind of information you, usually it is easy to produce the data, but then, after if for yourself, I see it also myself, if I produce today data and when I'm back next week, I look at the data and I ask myself the question, how is it being produced, etc. That's why Federico is also very clear in his whole tracing system. Yeah? So he, in fact, is almost appending to each data track, you could say a label, and how he produced it, etc. So that completely retrace it. Yeah.
In your archiving, you mentioned valuable data to select. Who should select?
I expected already that question. Yeah, that's an extremely, that's one of the big thing that we cannot answer that question, to be quite honest. Why not? If today data is not valuable, it might very well be that over 5 years that data is valuable. And so it depends on the moment. Yeah, we have seen that examples that we are producing now data, it has no value at all, and suddenly after a certain period of time, it gets valuable. So in general, there's no general answer for that. At the very moment, is it whether you consider it valuable data, roughly a definition, you could say if you are going to publish it, then the data is valuable, because that's already having an additional, so that's roughly the rule of thumb at the very moment. But even data that is not being published now might very well be interesting within a certain amount of years. So, I hope, Okay, then thanks once again for your attention.
I believe everything works fine. Yes, my name is Leon Ozinski. I'm from the library of this university. I'm also a member of the data stewardship team of this university. So the topic of my presentation is what funders, the research funders, want you to do with your data. Funders nowadays are important drivers for RDM, and I think you could see some parallels, for example, with the open access movement, where publishers, or where funders, I have to say, also, take the lead, so to speak. Now there are, Peter also mentioned it, dialogue sessions going on at this university on Plan S, an ambitious plan for a transformation to open access of publications. I think within 2 years or something like that, the same kind of meetings will be held by our board, but then about research data, about RDM, and so on and so on. Okay, having said that, what funders want you to do with your data? This is a newspaper article from 2011. And I think you can say from about 2010 or 2011, funders are making requirements on the RDM. I'm not sure this. I remember this paper, this article rather well. It stirred also a little bit of commotion then, because what NBO was claiming then, okay, our data, the research data from the fund, from the projects that we fund are also ours. We are co-owner of the data, and you should make that data public. That stirred a little bit of commotion. I'm not sure how NBO nowadays thinks of co-ownership of the data. Ownership of data is a complex topic, but making your data public is still a requirement, albeit in a little bit nuanced way now. So I have tried to put the requirements of the research funders in one sentence. So it's a long sentence and perhaps a little bit also incorrect. But, and this is also so the agenda, the overview of my presentations. what research funders want is to deposit the relevant data or the underlying data of your articles, I'll come back to that, in a repository to make these data fair, it's already mentioned a lot, fair, and open access available when possible, and to write those points 1 to 6 down in a data management plan. These are essentially the requirements of research funders. Okay, the first requirement, deposit. I've mentioned this separately because it is a must. This is one of the things you have to do from a funder. You have to deposit data. I'll come back, of course, to what data, etc. But you have to deposit data. And where do you have to deposit? First of all, what is data? It is digital data, but also non-digital data. Think of biomaterials, prototypes, designs, and that kind of stuff. So digital data, of course, I think that is the main part, and non-digital data. There is a difference between Horizon 2020 on the one hand and NWO, TTV and Zonenwe on the other hand. Horizon 2020 says what is data, that are the data underlying your publications. So to the data that validate the results that you present in your paper. And the NWO says data that are relevant for reuse. And it's up to the researcher what is relevant for reuse. He or she can decide, okay, I think these data are relevant for reuse, and so I need to deposit them, these data somewhere. There's also, as you can see, there is a kind of difference, perhaps it changes, but Horizon 2020 is more aimed at scientific integrity, validating the results of your paper. That's the reason why you need to deposit your data, and NWO is more aimed at reuse of your data. Both funders think it is important, but it's a difference in focus, perhaps, so to speak. Then you have to deposit in a repository. Negatively speaking, they are saying, so it's not good or not good enough when you just put your data on the internet or when you store your data on a mobile hard drive or something like that. That is not good, and that won't be approved by the funder. So they are really saying, okay, you have to use a repository, a data repository, for storing, for archiving your data. The funders don't mention specific repositories. They are giving a list of where there is an overview of repositories from which you could select a suitable repository. And Horizon 2020 is aiming at r3data.org. It's an overview, a registry of repositories of more than 2,000 repositories nowadays. And then NWO is aiming at the repositories with the quality mark data seal of approval. And behind that hyperlink, there is a list of 50, 60 repositories. I'm not sure about that. So they don't mention a repository, but they give you, select from this list a suitable repository. My advice in these cases is mostly, try to find a repository on your discipline. Try to find a good repository on your discipline. And good means the repository requires at least that you add some metadata to your data set, and that the repository assigns a DOI, a unique identifier, to your data set. If there isn't a good repository available on your discipline, on your discipline, then I advise for the EU Center for Research Data. It's our own data archive for the technical and engineering sciences, co-developed by Eindhoven, Twente and Delft, of course. And if you are more from the social sciences, there are also a lot of psychologists doing research at this university, for example, then advise Dans. In most cases, I will come back to 4TU Center for Research Data, but in most cases, 4TU RD is good enough for the funders, so to speak. Then it's already mentioned by Peter a lot of times. Yeah, FAIR is the new, let's say, buzzword with regard to research data management. It's already very good explained by Peter, the six levels of FAIR, so I won't go into detail anymore. But FAIR is also a focus of the funder. You could say that the first aim or purpose of the funders is that your data will be reused. The aim is reusing the data. The purpose is aimed at reuse the data. But the second focus is on FAIR data management. And of course, these two are connected. Reuse of data implies good data management, and what is good data management is data management guided by the FAIR principles. But it's an important focus of the funders also. It's ORD is the Open Research Data Pilot. It's from Horizon 2020, but it's in that quote. Then open access, if possible, I'll come back to that. You have to make your data open access. What is open access? It's still not worked out completely, so to speak, by the funders. But if you are looking at open access of publications, at the Plan S, for example, then open access is CC BY. Is a Creative Commons license, and the only requirement is attribution. I'm not sure, but perhaps open access with respect to data is also mean CC BY. So that means you have to make your data available with a CC BY, a Creative Commons BY license. There's a lot of discussion, especially about these licenses, and also with regard to open access of publications. And I don't think the last word is said about this. Is this a good license, CC BY, to make your data available? There's still a lot of discussion going on this topic. And then, when possible, so you don't need to make all your data open access possible, only when possible. And then there is this mantra, it's mentioned by each funder, as open as possible, as closed as necessary. So there are reasons not to make your data open, and there are the three more general reasons, valid reasons not to make your data open. So in a data management plan, when you are saying in a data management plan, I cannot make my data open, then okay, one of the reasons, then the reason should be one of these, and you should explain that. Then the last thing is, okay, you have to write everything down, points 1 to 6, in a data management plan. And that's also a must of the funder. You have to write a data management plan at the start of the project. Horizon 2020, it's within the first 6 months of the project, and NWO, within four months after approving the grant, after you have got the grant. And here are some of the questions that are asked in a data management plan. How do you store your data during your research, after your research? How do you document your data, the metadata, and that kind of stuff? And of course, the data preservation and archiving after the project. Everything with the FAIR principles in mind. So, in summary, I think this is what the funders ask, what the funder requirements are. You must deposit research data in a repository. This is more aimed at reuse of the data. And you must make the data as open as possible, as closed as necessary. Perhaps it's not a must, perhaps more a inspanningsverplichting, so to speak. I don't know the English word at this now. So make the data as open as possible, as close as necessary. And the third requirement is formulate a data management plan. That's a must. That is a must. And in that data management plan, you explain the fairness of your data, how you make your data fair. These are the three, let's say, basic requirements of all funders. Then, as I said, we can offer. I'm also one of the data stewards of this university, together with my colleague Chef and Twan. He is already mentioned. With regard to the funder requirements, we offer this kind of support. First of all, we can review your DMP. So we can help you with formulating your data management plan. When there is a new round, for example, with NWO, and some people have received a grant, we notice it. We notice it almost immediately because then mails are arriving. Okay, can you help me with the data management plan and so on. So we can help you with that, with the DMP, with the data management plan. It's not exactly a requirement of the funder. It's more a general legal requirement. But more and more you see that also in a DMP, attention is of questions arise about, do you handle personal data? And then, okay, you have to take special measures when you are handling personal data. And we can also help you with that. What measures do you have to take when you handle personal data as your research data? And then I think at the end of the research data life cycle, we have the 40U Center for Research Data. I, together with my colleague, I am the front office, so to speak, of 40U Center for Research Data of this university. And you can use 40U Center for Research Data for depositing, for publishing, for making your data public. If you need help with that, we can help you with that. With regard to 40U Center for Research Data, I have to emphasize it is for the it's called a data archive, but I have learned that archiving means something different from a librarian like me than from someone who is from the ICT department. But it is especially meant for the publication of static data. So especially what, the relevant data, what funders are asking for. For the publication of static data, frozen data sets, milestone data sets, data sets, the final data sets underlying your publication, etc., etc. And with 40U research data, these data are made fair to a certain extent. Not completely. There is a discussion, are we at level 4 or 5 with 40U Center for Research Data? But to a certain extent, when you deposit your data in 40U Center for Research Data, your data are made fair. because data are assigned a DOI, a unique identifier. Wait, I will take the next slide. Data are assigned a DOI. That's findable in terms of FAIR. Data can be linked to publications. A reservation of a DOI, a unique identifier of your data set, is possible. That's also findable. Then, very important, data you have to assign, you have to describe your data set with some metadata. That is also about findable, but the metadata are also interoperable. They are according to a metadata standard and also in the RDF format, so that is easy linkable to other objects. A user license of choice, reusable. You can attach a user license to the data set, a Creative Commons license. There are special software licenses you can use in 4TU, Center for Research Data. Data are now open access, so accessible. There is a project going on to also make the data, to add a restricted access functionality to the data in 4TU. They are archived, preserved for the long term, accessible. The archive has the data seal of approval, which essentially says that, okay, data are preserved at least for 15 years. We guarantee that. And then the metadata can be harvested by Google, etc., etc., so they are findable. So again, storing your data in 4TU, to a certain extent, your data are also FAIR, and you are, okay, you are complying to the funder requirements. Yes, here is the reference that you. This was my last slide. Okay, still some time for questions. Do you have any questions? I could show you 4TU, for example. Yes?
When you say open access, does that imply open access for free, or may it be open access at a fee?
Good questions. There are good question. There are two kinds of open access. Open as in free, as in free beer, or free as in free speech, so to speak. So no limitations, restrictions, I have to say, on the use. No, open access in this case means actually both. So the data set in 4TU, the data sets are now open access. That means they are free to download. It doesn't cost you any money, but that depends on the license. They are also free to reuse, which means you can, for example, modify the data set or something like that.
Maybe you can say something about the depositing costs. Maybe this question was about that.
Is it about the cost also?
It's about the cost of access. So if I want to have
okay.
publication and I have to pay, is that still open access? I would argue that it could be open access even if you have to pay a fee.
Yeah. That's true. That's you are right. But for using the archive in the sense of I would like to upload data in the archive, then yeah, for staff of this university, it's free till 1 terabyte a year. 1 terabyte a year, and. Other people, we are an international archive, so we also receive data sets from Poland, etc. It's free till 10 gigabyte. So if you exceed, then you have to pay. And the sum then is €4.50 per gigabyte per 15 years. That are the costs.
Okay, that is for the
uploader? That is for the uploader. Now for the downloader, it's free. For the downloader, it's free.
Yeah. Just to check that I understood you correctly, open access may also mean that a reader has to pay for reading the article.
Yeah.
The publication or whatever.
Okay, perhaps some people wouldn't think that if you have to pay, if it's behind a paywall, nevertheless free to reuse, I think a lot of people wouldn't say that is open access. But in till a certain extent, I agree with you. Oh, Paul?
I think by definition, open access means that you can read it for free, but this is a term which emerged from publishing. And I think what you can see, and I think this is something which has not been excluded, that if you have very elaborate infrastructure in a certain domain, then you can see practices that these infrastructures need to be maintained. And that is, of course, a very valid debate that even though you want to make things publicly available, who's going to pay for maintaining this infrastructure?
Indeed, open access is meaning you don't have to pay for the access.
Yeah, you don't have to pay for the access, but it also means.
But the effect is the cost and the effect is the person that puts it into the system is in fact paying it.
But it also means no restrictions on the reuse of the data set or the publication. That's all.
You're not free to modify the data, by the way. It's not that
it depends on the license. It depends on the license. With a CC BY, you are free to modify it without asking permission. But okay, that is indeed.
Okay, the funny situation arises that the term open access is also used in other domains. For example, like providing access to laboratory facilities. And then the user, of course, have to pay for it.
Yeah.
In different domains, it has a different meaning. Yeah. And it's used
like a bank, you can sit on a bank and you can also go to a bank for money.
Yeah.
I agree with you that it depends on the context. Yeah.
Okay. More questions? Some more questions? Oh, sorry, didn't see you. They are, first of all, they are asking questions about that in a data management plan. When will your data be available? In most cases, it is upon publication of your paper, then the data will also be made available immediately. Then the duration, indeed, it used to be 10 years. It's also in the code of conduct, so that you had to keep to archive your data for at least 10 years. Now no period is mentioned anymore, but we from 40U are saying 15 years. But it the funders now don't require let's say a period of 10 or 15 years anymore.
Okay. But if you then underbid,
yeah, I should go for 10 years. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So do you screen that?
There are some repositories have a quality mark, and it was mentioned the data seal of approval. It's a very light quality mark, a very basic quality mark. But in that, when you have that certificate, you are saying, okay, it's especially about the preservation of your data for the long term. That is what you are guaranteeing when you have that quality mark, that certificate. So in this way, yeah, we are monitoring that, yeah, by going for that quality mark, by applying for that. Is that an answer to your question? Yeah? Okay. Yeah? Okay? We are done? Okay. Thank you for your attention. Merci.